I was busy jamming out to my own intro song. What up, guys? Welcome. Welcome to Truffle Shuffle. Welcome to Eat Around the World with Chef Tuck. I happen to be Chef Tuck. All right. So, is anybody joining in for the first time? Who has never Truffle Shuffled before? Oh, my goodness. Team Skateri over there. Welcome. Chef Ryan in the house. Welcome. Awesome. So, all to my brand new and returning guests, welcome. Super excited to cook with you today. I'm obsessed with this recipe. I, like, couldn't stop thinking about it. So, let me introduce myself before we get started over here, in case you don't know me. So, again, my name is Chef Tucker, and initially I went off to university intending to become a nurse. I even graduated from university. I got that far. And then I had the sudden idea that... we had to adjust it to a tuck size camera. Thank you, DJ Jeremy.
You're welcome. You're all
right. Better. So I graduated from university, and then I had the bright idea that actually this was all a mistake and I wanted to make food instead. So then I went off to culinary school, and in culinary school I learned about Michelin starred restaurants. I learned that Michelin starred restaurants are like top tier elite restaurants. I also learned a lot of women don't make it into these top tier elite restaurants. And maybe you don't know me, but I'm a very stubborn human being. And I was like, I don't think so. And so I worked super hard and weaseled my way into the top tier, right? And so I worked at Ocarello. I was the sous chef there for a number of years, about 3.5-4 years. Really exciting, really fun. Learned a lot of cool techniques, and we're gonna get into a lot of those today. So, you know, my background comes from French culinary school. My background ethnically is Italian and Portuguese. And so we kind of have a mashup of French culinary techniques and a little bit of Italianity in everything that I touch. But today we are eating our way into France. All right, this very French recipe through and through. We also have one other special guest in this room today, all right? You might know him, the one and only DJ Jerbear in the house over here. So if you have any song requests, you pop those in the chat bar. He's very amenable to song requests.
Oh, yeah, song requests, please request. Mm.
Mm-hmm. But we will keep the French tunes going if you have no song requests, but we'll keep it French in here. And so one of the most important things that we need for this class today was a bottle of wine. And so you know me, I learned to cook from my Nona, and my Nona always had a little wine for the recipe and a little wine for Nona. Turns out that translates to our French recipe here today, all right? So I want to check out, what did you source for yourself as far as wine? Because this is also going in our sauce, but it's also our drinking wine. So what are we drinking today? Hold up those bottles. Jerbear's going to put you on blast. I want to see some delicious wine.
Some tables, queen.
There we go. Good choice. Team Mark over here. Ooh, that's a good one. Good one.
Yes.
All right, over at Tyra's house. Ooh, we got some Syrah going. Okay. Oh, nice bottle over there, Chef. Yeah, over at Lizzie's house. The Michael, the Joel got. Nice. We got double trouble at the Team Tool house. Excellent choice, guys. All right. Over at Michael's house. A solid bottle there, Chef. Chef Anna, welcome back. I love that bottle over there. Yeah, that's a good one. All right. Oh, Alan Kelly's. Yeah, good one over there. All right. Chef Karen, welcome. Ooh, Reverie, good choice. All right. Over at Janet's house, that is a giant bottle. Excellent choice, Chef. All right. Beautiful. All right, we came prepared to class today. Excellent job, guys. So, the best way to measure out half of a bottle of red wine is to first pour yourself and your sous chef half the bottle of wine out of the bottle for drinking, and then you have half a bottle of wine for your recipe. All right, that's how we're going to measure that today. Maybe you bought a second bottle for more drinking later. That's totally fine. We don't drink, what can I use? All right, so if anybody doesn't drink today and you don't want to use that red wine, you can just use the stock. I'm more heavy. Chef Carol might need a bottle and a half then, but I like your style. So for anybody who's not into the alcohol situation over here, you can just go with that stock, and then we'll do a little bit of flavoring that's slightly differently. So remind me when we get to sauce hour, and we'll talk through that a little bit better. Yeah, great question there, Chef. All right, so let's get into our recipe of the day. So we'll talk our way through it first, see what you've gotten yourselves into, and then we'll start cooking. So mise en place, right? Officially a French class, a French term. Mise en place just means everything in its place. As chefs, we want to track down our tools, get organized, then get wild. So we're going to need the classic cutting board and knife combination. Cutting board, knife, standard procedure. All right. We do need a lot of cookware items here today, all right? We want a little cookware heavy. We're gonna need a large cast iron pan or a large saute pan, all right? I love cast iron. That's gonna be for our fillets, and it's gonna get them nice and caramelized on the outside. Holds the heat in super nicely. I want a medium saute pan. We're gonna do our mushrooms in here. So we got two saute pans. And then we're gonna need two pots, one to confit our potatoes, one for our red wine reduction. So two pans and two pots. All right, so a lot of cookware. A few smaller hand tools as well today. We're gonna need a large spoon for basting those beautiful fillets. So if you've taken my steak classes before, we're gonna cook these very similar to how we do any other protein, right? We're gonna get them nice and dry, temper them, flip them a lot, baste them. It's how you get the perfect steak. All right, we're also gonna wanna go ahead and bust out a whisk. It is a Chef Tuck class, there's gonna be whiskey business involved. You knew coming in. If you've never cooked with me before, there's always whiskey business involved, all right? A wooden spoon, classic, like Nona used to have. 60% for stirring, 40% for other activities. All right, but wooden spoon, nonetheless. Something like that. All right, we wanna bust out a fine mesh strainer. Fine mesh strainer in a mixing bowl. All right, that's gonna be our little setup to get our potatoes out of there. All right. You also wanna go ahead and find a cooling rack. If you don't have a cooling rack, you can totally rest your steak on your cutting boards. That's fine, but cooling racks are great. And if you have a plate with some paper towels to bust out and dry and temper your steaks on. So if you haven't done this already, let's go ahead and pop those fillets out of those packages. And you wanna sit them on your paper towels. And so what we're doing here is we're tempering our fillets. Because if you just pull a piece of protein right out of your fridge and start throwing it in your saute pan, it's not gonna get an even internal cook temperature, right? If we want a nice rare to medium rare on that fillet, it's gonna have a funky internal temperature if you just pull it right out of the fridge. So we're gonna bring it up to room temperature here on the counter. And then we're gonna get it nice and dry, right? Super nice and dry. That's how you get that crust, right? Whether it's fish, chicken, steak, anything like that, moisture is the enemy of anything crusty. All right. And then I do need you to source a few things from your homes that were not in the kit. So one of those things being a pint of olive oil. That's gonna be to confit our potatoes in. You might not need the entire pint. I just wanted us to make sure we had enough, right? You just need enough to cover your potatoes so that nothing's like poking out. A splash of canola oil to get our steaks going in the pan. An ounce of sherry vinegar. If you don't have sherry vinegar, you can sub with something else, but that sherry vinegar is a really nice splash for those mushrooms. It's gonna give it a really nice flavor. Obviously our wine, I think we already covered that. And then a little black pepper. All right, and so those are the things you're gonna need from your kitchens out there. And those are your tools. All right, so how do we feel about those things? Thumbs up, we found all the things we need today. Excellent. So this is the first kit class. Oh, we got a question out there. What's up, Chef?
Two questions. One, if you couldn't find sherry vinegar, every store around here was out of it, will rice wine vinegar slightly sweetened work as a substitute?
Is that the only one you've got?
I've got apple cider vinegar and white
vinegar. I would use apple cider.
Okay.
Yeah, great question.
Second question, I don't use canola oil. A little olive oil, okay?
Do you have like a vegetable oil or grapeseed oil?
Not in this house.
Avocado, coconut, sesame?
No.
All right, if olive oil is the only thing you have, that's what we're gonna have to do here. All right. And here, three stores to find sherry. Sherry vinegar can be elusive. If you don't have sherry vinegar, apple cider will work. Let's see, Chardonnay vinegar, champagne vinegar. Those are some of my favorites over here. The last couple of years, oh my goodness, being in the restaurant industry and having purveyors to source things for you, I don't often run into those problems. But that's surprising that it's been years. Yikes. All right, so this is my first kit class in a while. You didn't have to source your own ingredients. That's exciting, all right? Let's talk about what came in this box besides your filet mignon.
We've got one more question coming in.
I love Team Lissy over here. What's up, guys?
Hi, is sherry wine the same as sherry vinegar?
Not exactly, but it'll work in the same kind of way for this recipe, so you can use a little splash of that for sure.
Okay.
Yeah, awesome. All right, so in this box, you had two beautiful filet mignon. I have a favorite chef, Gordon Ramsay, and he says that the filet mignon is the Rolls Royce of proteins. All right, so just so you know, if you're into cars, right, that's like a nice one. So we're doing the Rolls Royce of proteins one day. All right, so we got some wild mushrooms over here. We are getting wild. beef broth, all right? Anytime you are cooking a protein and you are cooking anything else to accompany that, you typically want to pair the stock with the protein. If you're cooking beef, use beef stock. If you're cooking chicken, use chicken stock. See where we're going? So we got some beef stock. We have rosemary and thyme, beautiful flavoring herbs here. Shallot and garlic, very French up in here, our fancy French onion. Got some fingerling potatoes. We're going to France. Obviously, there was going to be butter involved. And then, of course, Bolognese truffle salt to sprinkle on everything here today. All right. So, it's a lot of ingredients and tools, but it looks like we're pretty much ready to go. So, if you are ready to travel off to France, give me a wine swirl. Let me see that wine swirling away. Ooh, oh, we are swirling some wine. Excellent. We're really good at that. I love this. Yeah. That's definitely a skill we're all getting better at, is swirling the wine. And multitasking, but yeah, wine swirls on point.
The most important skill, universal
intuition. Yeah, honestly, yeah. Awesome. So, we're ready to get started. And if you took the fillets out of the package and put it on a paper towel, you have already done step... Oh, yeah, Chef Pam, I'm very classy over here. We've got the classic mason jar for the wine. Yeah. Yep. Yeah, sometimes I'm not that bougie. Sometimes it's just a mason jar. All right, so if you've already taken the fillets out of the package, step one is done. All right, so we'll go ahead and do step number two, which is smash a little garlic. All right, so we want to go ahead and pop out 3 cloves of garlic over here. And so for garlic smashing, all right, you want to put the flat part of your knife on here, hold it steady, and give it a nice Hulk smash. Boom. Smashing it up over here. Amazing. And now, if you're new to my classes, garlic is an ingredient. I always say people should measure with your heart. All right, there's actually 3 ingredients that are covered in that measuring with your heart scenario. One is garlic, one is wine, and the other one is Parmesan cheese. All right, so those are the 3 things. If they're ever in a recipe, just ignore what the recipe says and measure with your heart. If we got a double kit, should we double all of the things? Yes. Yes. I must have a huge heart. Tom, absolutely you do. Same. All right, so if you have smashed your garlic, we're pretty much ready to start getting our potatoes into confit mode. And so I know we use that term a lot here, right? We always say confit this, confit that. Confiting something basically just means cooking it in fat. Traditionally, confit was done in duck fat, all right? So typically that's what they're cooking things in, but you can cook it in any sort of fat or oil, right? You can confit in olive oil, in any kind of oil. So we want to find one of our pots over here, the medium one. And I'm going to pop my 3 smashed garlic cloves in here. Husks and all, right? And so the French have a term for when the garlic is still in the little husk over here. It's called en chemise, which means in a shirt. All right, so pop your garlic in its shirt into the pot. If we have duck fat, should we use it? Chef, yes. Yes, your confit potatoes in duck fat will be absolutely fire, definitely. All right, so garlic plus potatoes into our pot over here. And then go ahead and find your thyme and rosemary. All right. So I'm going to toss a rosemary sprig in here and a little bit of thyme. We're going to parcel it out between a lot of the things today, so I'm just going to put 1 sprig of rosemary in here and just a few sprigs of thyme. So I still have quite a bit left over. Because that's going to be our flavoring agents and a lot of the components of our dish today. So this is our medium pot. Medium pot over here. Or a saucepan. I don't know. There's a lot of different names for this, but I just call it a pot. Medium pot. So we've got some flavoring agents in here, right? Our garlic cloves, thyme and rosemary. And so now we want to go ahead and cover this in oil. All right, so that's our EVOO, our extra virgin olive oil. If you have a hidden supply of duck fat, definitely go bust that out. But if not, we're just going to use our olive oil. And again, you might not need the whole pint, but you do want enough to cover. Beautiful. All right. So when you confit something, you basically just want to let it gently, gently simmer until it's fork tender. So we definitely don't want to see any aggressive bubbling, certainly not boiling, right? None of that. Especially because olive oil has a low flash point, right? Whenever we talk about oils, like when we talk about canola oil for steak, olive oil for dressings and whatnot, it's really important because of the flash point. So Chef Carolyn, no, there's no oils in the kit. So those are two things we want to source from our pantry staples. And so olive oil having that low flash point, you don't want to let it boil because it's going to taste kind of acrid. So we're just going to let it gently simmer over here. So I'm going to put this on like medium low heat, and I'm just going to be very attentive to it and not let it boil. All right, so just kind of keep an eye on it. We'll come back. DJ Jeremy will help us keep an eye out. He's very useful.
Oh, yeah.
There we go. All right. So, again, we're just on medium-low heat over here, confing up some potatoes. Awesome. All right. Excellent. So, how do we feel about potatoes on the stove? Thumbs up. I did that. I crushed this. Nice. Awesome. So, we're going to confit that up. It's going to be amazingly delicious. And they're just going to be till they're fork tender, right? Just till fork tender. So, that was step two. That was step three. All right, we're crushing this. We're like flying through it over here. All right, so step four, time to get the wine involved. And I don't mean to like drink, I mean to actually use for cooking. So basically when you make a red wine reduction, you gotta reduce your red wine. All right, so we're gonna need our other pot over here. And we're doing half a bottle of red wine. Jeremy, does that look like half?
I think you could use a little more in your glass.
Oh, Jeremy.
Yeah, I think to get to halfway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So really measure it out, right? Make sure your glasses are nice and full so you have half a bottle, and then just go for it. Beautiful. So that is one half a bottle of wine into the pot.
What was the option for people who are going to use wineless?
And so if you are going wineless, what you're gonna do is you're gonna take the stock that we sent you, about a cup and three quarters of the stock that we sent you. Yeah, that's the one. And then just reduce that until you get about the same amount that we're looking for, about a third of a cup to a quarter of a cup. And then it's gonna kind of thicken up on its own. All right, because stock has a natural gelatin or collagen agent to it from all the collagen in the bones. And so as you reduce that, it will thicken up and get a little more gelatinous. So you'll have some texture to your sauce like how we will as well. And then we'll finish it with butter in the same kind of way. Good remembering, Jimmy. All right, so wine in a pot, wine in a glass. Give me a wine.
I'm sorry, how much? You want me to use how much stock?
About a cup and three quarters over here.
Okay.
Yeah. Team Launch has a very important question. What are the three things you measure with your heart?
Great question. Sorry.
It is wine, for sure, garlic, and Parmesan cheese. Yeah, great question. Is it worth to use high-quality Evo for confit, or is average Evo just fine? So is it similar to wine? That is a very solid question. I would say for confiting, it's less important because you're going to be cooking it. If you're doing any sort of like finishing oil, salad dressing, anywhere where you're not going to apply any heat to it, that's when you want to bust out those really nice olive oils. What temp on the wine? Great question, Chef. So we want to basically reduce this, and whenever you're trying to reduce something, you can crank the heat. So we can go on like high heat. Boom. And so one of the most important things about any kind of reduction, whether it's wine or anything else, is to make sure you don't leave it unattended for too long, lest you have no liquid left in your pot and you just start to burn your pot. All right, so we're gonna keep it close. That's exactly what happens. The chef starts to smell something burning. The chef comes over, starts yelling. Remember, this is French, right? The French chefs, they like to yell. I'm not French, so I'm not gonna yell at you, all right? But just know that if we were actually in France and you burnt the sauce, you would be in the juice, as Tyler likes to say, right? Big juice, all right? So, All right, so how are we feeling so far? Give me a wine swirl if we are on board. There's two things on the stove, we're chilling. Excellent. If you are ever panicking, you give me the side thumb, you start waving your arms, flag me down, shout out at me, anything like that. Added a couple extra potatoes to protect my marriage. Chef Michael, thank God. All right, yeah. Marriage is, the sanctity of marriage is important, and potatoes do hold it together. Yeah, that's what I've heard. All right, so we're doing really great over here. We're gonna continue getting to a little more mise en place together. All right, so it's a pretty mise en place heavy class. So next thing we wanna do is mince 2 cloves of garlic. So you know me, if I say 2, I'm probably gonna use 3 because my heart says so. Even if it's my own recipe, I still tend to off-road. In my class. All right. So I'm looking over here at my stove over here, and I've just got a very light simmer on my olive oil, just barely little bubbles coming off of my herbs. All right, and that's a great sign. I'm gonna keep it just like at that low heat. So Chef Caroline, if your potatoes are starting to boil, we wanna turn that heat down a little bit. So medium low to low heat for the potatoes, just so they're not boiling. You will see that little bit of bubbling around the herbs because that's the water escaping out of there. All right, so that's totally normal. My red wine is going, that's great, right? We're reducing that, we're not worried about it. So we're mincing up some garlic over here. And doing the Hulk smash will get them out of the chemises a little bit easier. And so whenever you're working with garlic, you always want to, that you're gonna eat at least, like for example, in our pot over here, the garlic cloves having the stem on it didn't really matter. But these we're gonna eat. So you wanna remove this little root end or little stem part. Right, because that never breaks down. You can cook that all day long and it's not going to break down. It's going to be very fibrous. So remove all the little roots off of your garlic cloves. I used to get roasted for that a lot. So that's a very important thing for me to mention. Yeah, that is not a corner we can cut. All right, so then you've got your garlic cloves over here. And for mincing, I like to go thin, thin slices first. Tuck your fingertips under your knuckles so you don't accidentally slice off your fingertip. Another very important chef tuck tip of the day. Once you have very thin slices of garlic, anytime you have something that is small, but you want it to be a little bit smaller, take your knife, hold the tip down with your non-knife hand, and you can just rock it back and forth. As I'm sure you know, the French have a name for this. This is called the haché. So go ahead and haché up a little garlic. All right. And I want to see some garlic haché out here. All right. This is one of the most important chef techniques besides the wine swirl, of course, right, is the old haché. Ah, Chef Karen, welcome back. Chef Karen already made vegan semolina cakes today, and now she's doing filet mignon. Chef is busy today. Looking good over there, Chef. All right, we got so back from another truffle crush of garlic. All right, Chef Lucky Anna Gray also back for another round of truffle shuffling. Excellent. All right, over at Gary and Laura's, we got some sous chefs up in there as well. What up, guys? All right, Pam and Pat, that is some perfect hashing. All right. Excellent. All right, Chef Brian, excellent job over there. Chris and Tina, how you guys looking over there? They're chilling. Excellent. All right, perfect, perfect. All right, all right. Excellent. Right on. So, that is our minced up garlic, right? So I'm gonna scoop my garlic over to a different area of my cutting board, kind of get out of the way. And now step five was one of those tricky chef tuck steps where I snuck like four things into one step. All right. You know, I like to do that. So we're still on step five. We're going to mince half of our shallot. All right. The shallot, as we like to call it here at Truffle Shuffle, is the fancy French onion, which works out really well for us today because we are in France. All right. So there's the root end of your shallot, the little eyeball, and then there's the tail. We're gonna go ahead and remove the tail from your shallot. And then with the root of your shallot facing away from you, you wanna cut it in half lengthwise, right through the root. So go ahead and get that crispy skin layer off of your shallot. All right. So each half of our shallot is going to do something different today. I know typically we cut the shallot in one way, both halves. Today we're doing one half in typical Truffle Shuffle style where we make a grid and cut it into perfect squares. The other one we're getting wild with. All right, so for the first one, we're doing a normal Truffle Shuffle style. If you're new here, you don't know what that is, and I would love to show you. So first step, Pac-Man cut your shallot. Basically you turn your knife sideways and you move it back and forth like this, right down the middle. However, you don't actually slice it all the way in half. All right, that's why it's a Pac-Man. It's got the little lid here. So, Pac-Man your shallot. So that's our center slice. And then from the root to where the tail used to be, you're gonna make vertical slices. Again, don't slice through that root. It is holding our grid together. You wanna try to land those vertical slices as close together as you possibly can. And then you get this nice little grid situation here. Once you have your grid, tuck your fingers under your knuckles, safety first, and then just mince or cut as finely as you can perfect little shallot squares. This is going to help flavor up our mushrooms. All right. So our gridded, squared up little shallots over here are beautiful. On your other half of your shallot, all right, so that was one half. The second half, we're not doing any of that funky cuts. We're just gonna slice little half moons. Just thin little half moons. And that's it, all right? So I've got three piles of alliums on my cutting board right now. Alliums being onions, garlic, things like that. So I've got minced garlic, minced shallot, and then shallot half moons over here. All right, so I would love to see your alliums all up on your cutting board. We're getting me flagged down. What up, chef? Just kidding. We're good? You got questions?
Question. I have turned my pot with the potatoes all the way down as far as it'll go, and it's still trying to boil on me. Suggestions.
Okay, no problem. So we do want a little bit of bubbling. So that's totally okay. Fine. Like this, you're totally good to go.
Okay.
Yeah, if it's light bubbles is fine. As long as it's not like roll at a rolling boil, like how you would cook your pasta or anything like that.
I don't know. It's getting pretty close to that.
Are we? Do you want to take me on an adventure? I would love to see in that pot.
Okay, hang on.
You can pick me up. It's fine. I'm very small.
Yeah, it's just my device may not be. Hold on.
Huh. You do have quite the boil there.
Yeah.
So, put your pot like half on the burner, half off the burner.
Okay.
Chef tricks. I like to say that chefs are like the MacGyver members of the kitchen, because if there is some sort of interesting problem, we will find an interesting way to fix it. Like, put your pot half on the flame.
Yeah.
It works. It will work. All right. So I want to see some allium action out there. What have we got? It's probably smelling pretty good out there. Alliums are a delicious flavoring agent. All right. What do we got out here, chefs? Al and Kelly, that was looking great. Chef Carol, crushing it over there. All right. We got Pam and Pat, beautiful. All right. Brenda and Andrew, nicely done over there, chefs. Mark, crushing it. All right, we got Chef Jeffrey. That is beautiful. Kathy, nicely done over there, Chef. Is Taco Cat around, Chef Kathy? I would love to see Taco Cat. K-Fab, nice mise en place. All right, Chef Janet, excellent job over there. All right, we got Chefs Carolyn and Elizabeth. Beautiful job. Team Lizzie, excellent job over there, guys. All right, Ed and Andrea. Oh my goodness, that cake is beautiful. Cake has nothing to do with filet mignon, I promise, but Chef Jeremy over here does baking at noon every Saturday before my class, and that's what they made. Karen.
Oh my gosh, all right.
Cake break over here. I'm fine with a cake break. Okay. That's fine. That is beautiful.
Yeah, it turned out really well. I'm super excited for it.
Cake! Yeah, I ate a giant piece of that cake. It is delightful, just so you know. All right, so your alliums are looking gorgeous. All right, our knife cuts are on point. Give yourselves a round of applause and a congratulatory sip of wine. So Chef Carol, I was just looking at that myself. So check out your pot. I've got about a quarter of a cup to a third of a cup of wine left. I'm gonna turn my heat off. All right, if you have a quarter of a cup to a third of a cup of wine left in your pot, go ahead and shut the heat off and we're gonna come back to that, all right? It's Taco Cat. Yes. Hi, Taco Cat. That is my favorite cat. Awesome. All right. He wears clothes. All right. So we've got some good mise en place of alliums over here. It's looking really solid. Okay. So the half moons or the rings of shallots that we just did, right? Not the squares, just the rings. Put the rings in your potato pot. Flavor. Going all the way to Flavor Town over here. Not a big Guy Fieri fan, but I do like saying Flavor Town. Oh, over at Jester's house, is that a doggo? Is that a doggo? Oh. I think it is.
Who let the dogs out? Who let the dogs out?
It was definitely Chef Jester over there. Cam and Pat, oh my goodness. There we got the babies.
Who let the dogs out?
Yes. Thank you for indulging me. You know that's one of my favorite moments.
We got
class.
Two more if you want to see them. We got all four.
Four? Oh my goodness.
I think they're outside.
Michael has a Taco Cat shirt. Kathy, if you don't have a Taco Cat shirt, I think you know what to put on your Amazon wish list this year. Yeah, that is phenomenal. Yes. Girl comes running for the Who Let the Dogs Out song. That is amazing. All right. It's phenomenal. All right. So we're going to go ahead over here and gather up a Chef Karen. The recipe does say half. You are correct. So you can add half to your pot over here. I added all of them, so it's too late for me. But if you read the directions, you're nailing it. All right. You can pull a few of them out if you want, because it's just going to be flavoring agents for something else. So it's totally fine. All right. So we are officially first. So basting. Ideally, the last of base is basting. So basting means add butter, and flavoring elements into your pan, turn the heat really low, and just give your steak a little butter bath on the way out the door. So we will be needing our stick of butter. All right, all one butter. If you use butter, it becomes ridiculously dish. And so you want to take it over here, and you want to find two tablespoons of butter. Definitely keep the rest of the stick out. We will be using more. All right, so into my little basting kit over here, I have 2 tablespoons of butter. I want to find 2 more cloves of garlic from that head of garlic and give them a little smash. And you want to leave the chemise on the garlic, right? Leave the little shirt on the garlic for your basting kit, because if you think about it, when you're basting, your saute pan is ripping hot, and if you throw a garlic clove in there without the little shirt on, it will start to burn pretty immediately. All right, so leave the little husk on the clove for your basting kit. So that's 2 tablespoons of butter, 2 smashed cloves of garlic. And then we're going to add some rosemary and thyme to this. A few sprigs of your thyme. And a sprig of rosemary. So I still have thyme and rosemary left, all right, just so you know. I'll give you a decent here. Out the basting kit. And if you were following directions, you can add the other half of your shallot rings into this basting kit. So let's check out those basting kits. How do we do? We have a basting kit ready for action to make these fillets next level. Carol, nicely done over there. Excellent. We got Tom, beautiful kit over there, Chef. Kathy, crushing it. All right. Team Mark, excellent job. Brendan, Andrew, beautiful job. Chef Margaret in the house. That's exactly what we needed. Beautiful. All right. All right, Anna, nicely done over there, Chef. All right, Brian, nicely done over there. Team Skateri, nicely done over there, guys. Excellent. I love the apron, too. Rock and roll, guys. We're doing great.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Jeffrey.
Team Launch. Nice. Chef Jeffrey. Excellent. Nice. Beautiful. So, basting kits is going to be one of the last things that we use. So, you can pop that off to the side over here. Make sure you're hydrating with your wine over here. Very important. Whew. All right. How are we feeling out there? Thumbs up. We are chilling. Side thumb. We're panicking. You've lost me. Awesome. Nobody's lost. Excellent. All right. We're still in France. All right. Nobody should be lost. We're in France. Everything's fine. So our potatoes are still confiting. If you're wondering if they're done, you can grab yourself a fork and poke them. They're not going to be done. But you can do it if you wanted to. All right. But fork 10 is what. And if your potatoes even size, right, then the little ones are going to be done faster than the larger ones. And we can always pull those out a little bit sooner. All right, and just a reminder, did anybody not turn their wine pot off? Or a third cup, keeping up, right? Third of a cup to cook.
Yeah, mine's right. Still
so
like
other- we've reached the last prep.
Well, there you go.
It is a pro. All right, a little more. We got. Of our prepped our varieties of mushrooms over here. So we added 2 varieties of mushrooms up in here because mushrooms are one of my favorite vegetables. You know, they're technically like a fungus, but I call them a vegetable just to hedge my bets. And I love mushrooms. So we've got these beautiful shimeji mushrooms over here. These over. So both of these are grown hydroponically, which means in water without any soil involved. So they're super clean and ready to go. And they're both very easy to prep, which is why I also like them the best. All right, so go ahead and pop them out of the package. I'm going to start with the maitakes first. They're a lot more fragrant, and I just like to start with that. Yeah, Chef Michael, the maitake is so fragrant. It's wild. And so if you lose some of the little petals, definitely just keep them because we'll just throw them in the pan. All right. Okay, so maitakes are a very crumbly mushroom. Just taking it out of the box, mine has already like split into a bunch of pieces. All right, but we were going to quarter it anyway, so it doesn't matter. All right, but in any event, if yours didn't just like break apart, go ahead and quarter your maitake. And then go ahead and, there we go. This little part right here is like the stem. Go ahead and remove just that little bit of stem from the maitake. Right, just this little part right here where it attaches to that little stem part, you just snip right off. So we have beautiful clean up maitake quarters. And put it right there. All right, so I break the petals apart super easily with my fingers. And we're looking for bite-sized pieces here, all right? So don't overthink this too much. So again, you got your quarter of your maitake. Where the petal meets the stem right here, go ahead and give yourself a little cut. And then you can break the petals apart with your fingers. Again, bite-sized pieces, totally fine. We're gonna sear these up. We're gonna add a little sherry vinegar in there, our shallot and garlic. It's gonna be super, super delicious. I first learned to pair sherry vinegar with mushrooms when I was working at a little bed and breakfast out in Winters, California, which is exactly two steps over from the middle of nowhere. But it was a really cool restaurant, and I was a young cook back then, and I had never had sherry vinegar and mushrooms before, and it was like a game changer. And so if you've not put sherry vinegar in your sauteed mushrooms, this might just change your life. All right, I don't want to like blow it up or anything, but like this is kind of like super delicious. All right, so you got your petals. So you got your petals over here, right? Your mushroom petals, you broke them into like bite-sized pieces, but now we have these stems over here. You can also just cut those into bite-sized pieces. Mushrooms. I'm gonna collect these in a little bowl over here. All right, so that is one variety of our magical mushroom medley over here. Ooh, okay, Lucky and Julian have a great question. If I had to choose between sherry wine on them really well, why don't you go sherry wine just to keep that flavor in there? I mean, I really can't speak highly enough about sherry wine in sauteed mushrooms. It just really complements it. So I know it's a little different than sherry vinegar, but it should still get that nice flavor profile. This reminds me of my farro salad class with the presentation maitake. Time to bring that one back. That was a delicious one. We got some red wine. Oh, Chef Carolyn. Yeah, red wine vinegar. You can do a little splash of red wine vinegar. Yeah, that'll work. Yeah. Yeah, that should work. So give me a thumbs up if you crushed your maitake and it is off to the side. Okay, cool. Just checking. All right. Do we need another sip of wine? We're looking asleep. Swirl the wine. Sip some wine. Chris and Tina asking some important questions. If the potatoes are soft, you just shut the heat off. Go ahead and start poking things over here with my fork. My smaller ones seem to be fork tender. My larger ones are a little bit on the firm side. But I'm going to go ahead and turn the heat off on mine because I'm pretty sure that the carryover cooking will take the larger ones just to that done point. All right. So I have a few in here that are kind of medium to small size. They're totally soft. They're going to be great. These couple of larger ones, a little firmness to them. So I'm going to shut the heat off and just let them hang out in the oil. And that little bit of firmness in the larger ones will get fully cooked out. Carol D, yeah, you can use, if you have like the sherry wine or actual sherry, you can use a little splash of that. If you're like sherry vinegar was not at Safeway, I don't know what to do. Yeah, you can just add a little splash of that sherry wine. All right. Potatoes are off heat, thumbs up, side thumbs, still cooking potatoes. Just trying to get a gauge of where we're at over here. Quite a mixed group. Most people are like, nah, not even. Okay, no problem. We got a lot of time still, so we're chilling. All right. It's good that mine are done, though, because I only have two burners and I need the stove space. All right, so you guys are good to go. All right. So we have one more mushroom variety to get into over here, and that's our shimejis. And so the maitake was pretty easy to prep. This is even easier. So again, hydroponically grown. Careful of the vinegars over here. From the four that you've listed, I would go champagne. I thought we had sherry, it was brandy. Chef, if you want to add a little brandy in there, I mean, I'm not going to be mad about it. Awesome. All right, so these are our shimeji mushrooms. I just think that they're super cute. Right, we're gonna slice it right there, all the way. All right, this is a one cut wonder mushroom. My mushroom prep is done. A one cut wonder. Don't make your lives harder than it has to be, right? One cut and they are done. Remember, if you're a professional chef in a restaurant, your prep list is longer than a CVS receipt. And you have like 2 hours before dinner service and your French chef is yelling at you. All right, you gotta move. All right, so one cut wonders are the way to go. Kathy over there, what do you got, chef? What do you got? Champagne vinegar. Chef. Chef, what's going on in your vinegar cabinet over there, chef? All right, I'm loving it. You got options. We love options. All right, so I'm gonna go the bottle on the left just because it's short and I'm short. And that is purely the reason why. There we go. Sometimes decisions are that simple. All right. So I want to check out your mushroom action out there. All right. We got a wild mushroom medley to accompany our filet mignon, right? Rolls Royce of proteins. So we got some Rolls Royce mushrooms. Oh, Chef Tom, that is a pile of mushrooms over there. That's looking great. Chef. Julianne, you are washing it, nicely done. All right, excellent job. Okay, awesome. All right, can you hear me now? Thumbs up, you can hear me now? You can see me? I'm not frozen? Amazing, okay. I thought it was me. It was not you. It was me. Not typically something I have to say. All right. And anyway, we finished our mushrooms. We're doing great. That was welcome back. Thank you. Oh, goodness. All right. Are we cutting up the stems of the second mushroom? No. So, Carol, the stem on that second mushroom is just a toss or a compost kind of situation. Yeah, it's a little stormy here in Oakland, California at Truffle Shovel headquarters. Something called a bomb cyclone of a storm has come through. It's something like that. Exactly, guys. Yeah, there were people, I don't know if you saw any photos on the news, but there were people surfing in the streets of San Francisco. I would never, because I don't know if you've been to San Francisco, but it's kind of gross. So don't do it, all right? But you could, because it's flooded. So taking out the Wi-Fi over here. All right, so grab a little wine. We've finished prep during class. Give yourselves a round of applause. We're doing great. All right, we're really crushing over here. Compost, yeah, we do compost here. Chef Connie set that up. Chef Connie was amazing. She set up our compost program here.
Oh yeah.
Constance MC. All right, so we've prepped all the things, right? There was a lot of knife skills, a lot of this, a lot of that. Oh, the 49ers won? No way, we never win. That's amazing. Yes! Football! I don't know anything about football, but I'm a Niners fan because I'm from here. That's all. All right, so we're going to apply some heat and cook some things over here. So we're going to start at how to cook step number one. All right, and we're going to refer back to that wine that we reduced. We're just going to kind of season this up a little bit. So we want to add 1 3/4 of a cup of beef stock into this pot, which is not the whole container, so you will need to measure it over here. Chef Denise is also Niners all the way. Yes. We're just having a moment, that's all. Niners are having a quick little moment. All right. So that's 1 3/4 of a cup of beef stock into my reduced wine. All right, so you had about 1/3 or 1/4 of a cup of wine left in your pot. It's been off heat. We're adding 1 3/4 of a cup of beef stock up in here. And then we're gonna put it back on like medium to medium high heat.
You had me use my beef stock. So all I have left is this.
Oh, okay. Perfect. Okay. Yes. Yes, Chef. So you have the other stock in your pot, so you're not going to do anything further to that sauce. We're just going to fold in the butter a little bit later.
I'm not going to use both?
No. So the stock that's left in your container, we're going to kind of split between our mushrooms and whatnot, but in your pot right there should be good, and then we'll fold in a little butter.
This is what's in my pot right now. Hold on a second. Gosh.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, we'll emulsify a little butter into that in a few minutes, and then it's going to be super delicious.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, for sure. Awesome. So, now that we've got that going, all right, it's going to hang out. It's going to reduce a little bit further over here. And like I said, we're going to kind of finish it with a little butter, right? The French move is kind of finish everything with butter. And so we are absolutely going to do that here today. All right, we're pretty much going to use a lot of the butter from that stick. All right. So, that's just, again, on like medium to medium high heat. It's going to reduce a little bit further. And so we're pretty much ready over here to get our mushrooms going. All right, so you're gonna need your medium saute pan, not your cast iron, but your medium saute pan. And we wanna get this on high heat. We wanna make sure we get a little bit of a crusty sear on our mushrooms, all right? We call it GBD, golden brown and delicious. That's an actual chef term we use in restaurants, all right? Because as it turns out, we are just a bunch of goofballs. So we're getting it GBD up in here. And so does anybody know why we heat our saute pan first before we add oil or anything else in there? Pop it in the chat. Why do we heat our saute pan dry first? There is a reason, and it's not just because I'm full of it. There's an important reason. So the scratches will close up. Yes, to stop the sticking. Yes. Exactly. So if you've ever had anything stick to the bottom of your saute pan, I for sure have lots of things, many things. The thing is, if you heat it first, the little micro scratches that live in your saute pan that just happen naturally from you cooking in it will kind of disappear because metal heats up when it expands, right? nerd alert. And then you add your oil in there. You basically created a non-stick surface for yourself. So if you've ever had fish skin stick to it, chicken skin stick to it, your steak stuck to your pan, that's not going to happen anymore because now you have all the secrets, right? You've got the chef secrets. All right. So we're going to go ahead and kind of hover your hand over your pan. If you're feeling some heat coming out of there, you can pretty much go ahead and add in a little splash of canola oil. So just enough to give yourself a small lining at the bottom of your pan. All right, my suggestion was like 2 ounces, just a little bit at the bottom of your pan over here. And so you can see when you kind of swirl your saute pan around, it kind of ripples, right? The oil ripples from the center to the outer edges. That means your oil is getting nice and hot. All right, so that's a great thing. And so you want to get your pan super, super hot because these are just mushrooms, right? So they're not going to take very long to cook. So you want to make sure you get that golden browning on them pretty immediately and when you get them in there. And so I can kind of see a little bit of smoke rifts coming out of my pan over here. And I know my stove is a lot more sensitive than some of yours out there because you're always like, chef, you're ahead of me. My stove's not that fast. So just give yourself the time. Wait until that oil is just smoking or until you see that ripple action in your oil, and then you can add those mushrooms. All right, how we doing out there? Thumbs up, I have oil in a pan ready to add mushrooms. All right, let's go ahead and add in some mushrooms, guys. If they're not sizzly when you drop them in there, it was a little bit early. You want that nice sizzle action going. Oh, we got a stove cam shot over at Team McDowell's. Nice, looking good over there, chef.
Ooh, mushrooms going in.
Mushrooms galore.
Oh yeah.
Over at the Skateri house, we got mushrooms in a pan. Nicely done, guys. All right, so what we're doing over here is we're gonna wait for a minute before we season it. So keep showing off those mushrooms. I wanna see it. Don't add any salt yet, we're not there. Chef Michael, those are beautiful.
Yeah.
All right, we got Karen Townsend. You are crushing it over there, chef. All right, excellent. Should start smelling delicious out here. Oh, nice. Alan Kelly, beautiful. All right, Team Launch is taking us over here. Beautiful mushrooms, guys. All right. Oh, Brian, those are beautiful. Nicely done.
Oh, yeah, Chef.
Oh, Chef Jeffrey, excellent job over there, Chef. All right. Y'all are crushing this. All right. So whenever you're working with mushrooms, you never want to go ahead and season your mushrooms until they start releasing some of that juice. If you tried to season your mushrooms right when you put them in the pan, they're dry, they're not gonna, the salt's not gonna stick to them, it's just gonna fall to the bottom of your saute pan. So once they're kind of coated in oil, once they start to release some of that inner moisture inside of them, then you grab your Balinese truffle salt and you give them a healthy sprinkle of salt. Mushrooms are like little sponges, so they love seasoning. I'm giving myself probably a good teaspoon, right? A good teaspoon of salt. I'm seeing some nice golden browning on my mushrooms over here. It's starting to smell super delicious. I forgot to mention, but if you have a hood vent or a fan or a window in your kitchen, you wanna go ahead and activate that, right? Open a window, turn your fan on. We're starting our high heat cooking process, so you're gonna wanna get a little airflow going. All right, get a little airflow going for yourself. Fan, hood, vent, window. All right. So there's a very professional chef technique that I would love to teach you. All right. So you're stirring your mushrooms with your wooden spoon over here, right? Just like Noni used to do. But then in your other hand, you've got your glass of wine and you are sipping and stirring simultaneously. All right, this is known as the sip and stir maneuver.
Oh yeah.
Very professional chef technique. I want to see your version. What do we got? Oh, Chef Tom crushing that. Kathy, excellent job over there. Team Launch, I see you over there. I see you over there. All right, Carol doing the sip and stir. Pam and Pat sipping and stirring. Wow, you guys have really got this technique down.
Oh, yeah.
Awesome. Mark's doing it over there. Excellent. We got Carol crushing that sip and swirl. Yeah. Alan Kelly over there. Excellent. All right. Beautiful. All right. So I'm looking at my saute pan over here, and I've got a nice golden browning. So I'm going to turn my heat down to medium, and then, yeah, Michael, now we're adding in the shallot and the garlic. But you got to turn your heat to medium first. Otherwise, the alliums will kind of burn. So your minced garlic and shallot, right? Your minced garlic and shallot, once you see golden brown on your mushrooms, you can throw your minced garlic and shallot into the pan. And you don't want to get browning on your garlic or your shallot here. You kind of want to just gently sweat them down. And so if you see them start to burn, turn your heat down a little bit further. But those are going to be our beautiful flavoring agents. All right, beautiful flavoring agents over here. All right. My kitchen smells unreal right now. That is so good, Chef. That is so good. All right, I'm looking next door at my red wine reduction sauce. Let's see what it tastes like so I can tell us what's going on over here. All right. Needs a little bit more, but I've got about a cup of liquid left. All right, got a cup of liquid left. How much wine reduction beef stock combination do you have left? Do you have about a cup? Give me a thumbs up. About a cup of red wine beef stock situation? About? All right, side thumb, not quite yet. All right, cool, cool, cool. So we're roughly on the same page on that. All right, no problem, no problem. So that's still working over there. And we've got our mushroom medley hanging out over here, getting super, super delicious.
Hey, Chef, we have like this weird, like black kind of film in ours. I don't know if you can see that, but.
Yeah, so that's going to be all the tannins from your wine kind of coming out, and that's totally normal. Yeah, okay. Mine does too. Mine just has a dark bottom pot, so you can't really see it, but yeah, that's totally normal. That will happen, and it's not going to come out in the final sauce. It's going to kind of stick to your pot a little bit, so it's going to be fine.
Thank you.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, a little sediment we're not worried about too much over here. Oh, lucky, that looks beautiful. Yeah, nice. All right. So my mushrooms are smelling super delicious over here. My shallot and garlic are now beautifully sweated. All right, so they're very fragrant. My shallot's no longer purple. My garlic is nice and soft over here. And so at this point, right, once your alliums are very fragrant. Oh, Chef Jenny, you got a question over there? What's up, Chef?
Yeah, I saw my reduction. I have a lot of fluid, a lot of liquid. What is it? What's it supposed to taste like, or how much are we gonna need? I guess.
So at this point, if you tasted it, it's probably gonna taste pretty bitter at this point. So we're not quite ready for it to be. It's not gonna taste good yet. Let me just say that it's not gonna taste great yet. It's still in the process of cooking. We're gonna reduce it down, maybe like 3/4 of a cup to a half a cup of sauce at the end of the day over here.
Okay.
You got a little time. Yeah, you got a little time.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, no problem, Chef. So once you've got golden brown delicious mushrooms and your shallot and garlic are fragrant and softened, that's when you want to go ahead and add in your splash of sherry vinegar or whatever vinegar situation you worked out. All right, I know we had a lot of vinegar conversations today, so whatever vinegar you got, pop that in here. It's a deglaze, right? We are deglazing our pan the same way that you would deglaze with, say, wine, alcohol, beer. Works in the same kind of way, right? That vinegar, that splash of vinegar in there lifts all the little stuck bits off the bottom of your saute pan, reincorporates them into your sauce over here, or your, in this case, vegetables. And so once you add that sherry vinegar, we want to cook the sherry vinegar au sec, which is another of those French terms. And au sec simply means nearly dry. All right, so you basically want to reduce all that sherry vinegar until there's basically no liquid left in that pan. All right, so give yourself a minute over here.
Do I use the red wine vinegar or do I use the apple cider vinegar? I completely spaced out for a moment.
If you have the choice between the two, I would go apple cider, but you could use either one.
And how much? I'm sorry, I spaced out.
No problem. About an ounce or so. Yeah, just like a little. Yeah. I like literally measured mine in a shot glass. So, you know, just like a splash.
Okay.
And so once you have an aw sec situation, right? Not like puddly liquid in your pan, that's a great point where you can go ahead and add a quarter cup of your beef stock. And if you're just a few seconds behind me, no problem. We're all going to cross the finish line together over here. I am mail ordering a massive bottle of sherry vin, everyone by now. There you go, Carol. Yeah, so we're doing vinegar in our mushrooms, K-Fab. Yeah. All right, so once your vinegar has reduced au sec or nearly dry, you want to go in with your quarter cup of beef stock. Quarter cup of beef stock. And then we're going to kind of reduce that down as well. I'm still chilling here on like medium high heat. Kind of medium heat. There we go. And so the stock is going to reduce. And it's gonna look kind of glazy in your pan, all right? Kind of glazed looking. And so as that stock is kind of reducing in that pan, you wanna come back to your cutting board for more butter, all right? Because the French tend to finish everything with a little butter. That's why French fruit is so rich and delicious, because everything has butter and cream in it, right? They even took Italian risotto and they threw cream in it. They didn't need it, but they did it, all right? So. Grab your stick of butter. We need two more tablespoons. So, my stock has reduced significantly, and my mushrooms are left with just a little liquid in the pan. Nice golden brown deliciousness, and they're looking kind of glazed. And so if you're with me on that, then you can go ahead and grab that two tablespoons of butter and pop that in your pan. And once you pop the butter in, go ahead and turn the heat off. And you're just gonna let that butter emulsify with that beef stock and create a little bit of a mushroomy, sherry, beefy mushroom stock over here. So Chef Carolyn and Elizabeth, the basting kit's gonna be for our fillets. Yeah, great question. Yeah, we set ourselves up for steak success with a basting kit. So I'm emulsifying my butter in off heat. And check that out. Look how creamy and delicious that is. We've got a little mushroomy kind of sauce going over here between the beef and the beef stock and the butter. Ooh. And you know it's packed with that little splash of sherry vinegar zing to it. All right. How we doing? Thumbs up. I have butter mounted into the mushrooms. Yeah, you do. Awesome. So now's a great time to bust out your favorite tasting spoon and make sure that we crush this. All right. It might need a little more seasoning. Maybe you want a little more acid. It's your adventure. All right. So get a tasting spoon. Check it out. See how we're doing. That's bomb. All right. I'm going to need a little more salt because I add more salt to everything. If you think you seasoned yours properly already, you don't have to add more salt. Oh, beautiful. Oh, Chef DJ Jeremy.
Ooh.
Do you need a taste test,
yes,
Chef?
Please.
Always feed your DJ, right?
Ooh.
That's not bad.
We have DJ Jerbear approval on our mushrooms. How are your mushrooms tasting? Super fire. It's that sherry vinegar. It's that sherry vinegar and that butter in there. All right, we got a couple of questions. Chef Tyra over there.
Yes, question. Am I supposed to have 4 tablespoons of butter in here, the mushrooms by now? 4. Okay.
Just two. Unless you have a double kit. Double kits will go 4, but yeah, for a single kit, just do 2 tablespoons. Awesome. All right. So, my potatoes, my cold feed potatoes are off heat and soft. My mushrooms are done. And at this point, all right, my red wine reduction is just about ready to take a look at over here. All right, so I've got about 1/3 cup, 1/4 cup of liquid left in my pan. Chef Karen, I could just eat the mushrooms and be in heaven. I know, Chef, I love that little splash of vinegar in the mushrooms. It really just takes it to that next level. I could just eat the mushrooms and just be happy as well. I love mushrooms. All right, so our sauce over here is looking pretty good. You got about 1 cup of liquid. Okay, you want to reduce that to about 1/2 cup. All right, at most you want 1/2 cup of red wine reduction over here, right between the beef stock and the wine. Eventually, you want about 1/2 cup of liquid or so. Yeah, about 1/2 cup of liquid. Awesome. Turned it back up to a boil. There you go, Chef. There you go. Awesome. And so I know it's hard to see on mine, but mine also is depositing all the tannins on the side of the pot. Oh, there it goes. You can totally see that. Yeah, so we lost all the tannins on the side. That's kind of the bitterness, right? When you have a tannin-heavy wine, that's the bitterness. That kind of what makes you go a little bit prickly in the back of your throat when you sip it, right? That little kind of eh. So we're going to mount it with butter a little bit later. But if some of us are still reducing, we want to kind of do that together. So give me a thumbs up if your wine and beef stock concoction is about 1/2 cup. Side them, I need more reduction. More reduction, chef, stop going so fast. Got it, no problem. All right, so we have been cooking up a storm in here. My question is, how are those wine swirls coming along? Over at the Bloomberg's house, we seem to have a serious problem over here. Oh, the sous chef is fixing it as we speak. There we go, sous chef recovered. Good recovery, chef. Fast hands. All right. Saved it. Awesome. All right. So it is at this stage that we're going to need a second bottle soon. Chef Carol, second bottle. Definitely do it. All right. So we're officially over here on how to cook step 5, which is season up our fillets. We're just about ready to dig into the mushrooms. We'll make it to the end. I know it's hard. When I was doing the photo shoot for this class to get all the photos for the website, I was working with Chef Jason, and when it came time to take the photo, there was like 1/2 as many mushrooms as I started with, and I was like, Chef, did you eat all the photo mushrooms? Yes, he did. So I understand. I very much understand. All right, so we're just about ready to get into our Rolls Royce of proteins, all right? And so my favorite way to cook a filet is rare. All right, so I'm gonna cook a rare filet. I promise I'm not gonna judge you whatever temperature you wanna cook yours at. I know a lot of people will. I'm not one of those people. But I'm gonna cook mine to rare. If you want yours medium rare, you're gonna add about 30 seconds to 45 seconds longer. For medium, probably about 1 minute. Medium well, 1.5 minutes. And well done, you're just gonna leave it there for a really long time, and I might cry a little bit, but not until I'm off camera, okay? So we're good to go. And so I have a foolproof way to know what temperature your steak is without poking holes in it with a thermometer. Because at a Michelin kitchen, you are not allowed to poke holes in the Rolls Royce of proteins, right? Not allowed. They will yell at you for sure. So Ed and Andrea, no, not yet. We're gonna wait until everybody's ready to make the sauce, then we'll do it together. Yeah. So hold your hand up in the air. So very weird little activity here. Excellent. All right, so put your pinky and your thumb together and then poke this little nugget of meat on your hand. I went to science school, I forgot what this is called, but it's called a meat nugget for our purposes today. So this is what rare is gonna feel like. It's kind of squishy, right? Kind of squishy. Put your ring finger in. That's medium rare. There's a little bit more firmness to it, but still on the squishy side. Add your middle finger in there. That's medium. You see that tension starting to build there? Now add your pointer finger. It's pretty firm. Closed fist is well done. That's not going anywhere, right? That's like hockey puck. All right, so that's how you know. That is your foolproof way, right? Rare, medium, medium well, well. All right, who knew my hand trick already? Give me a thumbs up. I already knew that, chef. I know, all my gastronomy gangsters knew that. All right, so hopefully if you didn't already know that, now you know, right? So if you don't know, now you know. So we're gonna go ahead and season up these fillets. All right, I know typically we do just salt. We're gonna add a little pepper in here today, all right? This is where your black pepper comes in. I love steak with pepper. I think they really complement each other beautifully. And so with filet or any protein, really, you can be pretty generous in your salt application. Meat can handle a decent amount of seasoning. And we're gonna season both sides. And I like seasoning on the plate that they were resting on. I just moved the paper towels out of the way. Because then any salt and pepper that fall by the wayside, you can kind of mop it up with the meat. Team Launch says, my husband isn't paying attention. All right, husband, you're in troubles. I don't know what kind of troubles, but troubles. As long as he's refilling the wine glass, honestly, then he's probably doing the perfect amount of help over there. All right, so any fallen by the wayside seasoning, use those fillets. You can roll them around, right? We want to mop up all of this delicious salt. If you've never tried our Balinese truffle salt before, it comes from Bali. And we source all of it from this one woman and her family. Like, they don't have any other clients because we buy every single grain of salt that they have. We add truffle and porcini powder in the mix. It becomes this really nice umami flavored kind of salt. Truffle salt to season or only finish? So many salt questions. So, chef, yeah, we want to use the Balinese truffle salt up in here. I mean, you can use kosher flake salt if you like. I just am a big fan of truffle salt. Excellent. We would love to. All right, so we got our fillets seasoned up over here. And so before we cook them, all right, I want to see your Rolls Royces ready to go, seasoned up, ready for action. Hold it up, show it off. Let's see those beautiful steaks. Carrie Townsend, that is a gorgeous fillet over there, chef. All right, Chef Jeffrey, double trouble. I love it over here. Michael, beautiful job. All right, Pam and Power, we're ready for action over here. Team Launch, gorgeous. Chefs Carolyn Elizabeth, nicely done over there. Those look beautiful. KFab, excellent. All right, Eddie Andrea, those are perfect. Is that an extra one for Arrow? Oh, Mark, nicely done over there. All right, Janet, nicely done. All right, Kirsten David. Oh, Chef Julian, what up, bud? There's no lemons in this recipe today. You're safe. Team Jester. Oh, we're busting a dance move. I know this song gets me too. All right, Alan Kelly, beautiful. Over at Carol's house, amazing. Chris and Tina, look at those. Those are awesome. Tom, crushing the steak game over here. Excellent. Margaret and Craig, those are perfect. All right. These look fantastic, guys. Team Lissy over here, nicely done. Yeah, all right. We have crushed this, this protein. All right. Excellent. So, our fillets over here. Remember, you want to cook it to your internal temperature that you would like. So again, I'm going rare on mine. And the most important part of this is the last 30 seconds when you are going in with that basting kit, make sure you get them nice and basted. And we're going to be flipping them every 30 seconds over here. Oh, so Chef Tyra, we want to make sure we have about like a cup of liquid left, about a half a cup of liquid. That's what I've got over here. Awesome. All right, so got about a half a cup to about half a cup of liquid. Yeah, half a cup of liquid over here should be good to go. All right. For our steak, you want your largest saute pan, cast iron pan. You definitely want to make sure your fan vent or window is activated. All right, And so we're going to flip our steaks every 30 seconds throughout the duration of the cook time. And the reason that's important is, have you ever gone to a restaurant and you noticed the inside of your steak might have been medium rare and the skinny pink stripe in the middle, but there was like a weird gray ring around the pink stripe in the middle? That's because it's well done on the outside and medium rare on the inside. You can do that. It's fine. All right. But we're going to do it better because we are gastronomy gangsters. All right. That's what we are. That's what I call all the chefs that take my class, in case you're like, what in the world is a gastronomy gangster? You're a good gastronomy gangster because you're in my class. All right. Welcome. So what we're going to do is we're going to make this next level, right? You're not going to take a Rolls Royce and let me drive it around the hood. All right. You're going to park that baby in a beautiful garage. All right. So you want to make sure we treat these with the utmost respect. You're going to flip it every 30 seconds. Yes, it is. Yes, it is, chef. All right. So we're going to flip these every 30 seconds because we're not going to get that overcooked gray ring. It's going to be perfectly pink from bottom to top. All right. You don't have to get the gray ring. This is how we cook steaks in Michelin kitchens, or any protein for that matter. You flip it very often because we're preserving the integrity of the inside as we build the crust on the outside. All right. You can have all the things. You just have to do it in a very specific way. All right. And I know it sounds like it's going to be a lot more complicated than it is. I promise it's not as hard as it sounds. All right. I promise. Remember, I do this for like a living. All right. It's not as hard as it seems. So to the saute pan, high heat, no oil. Why? No stickage, right? No stickage on the pan. All right. So cranking my cast iron pan all the way up to high heat. All right. I'm sorry. I have been lacking in my hydration advice over here. If you need a little hydrating moment over here before it gets really hot by the stove, take your little wine moment. Totally fine. Tyler and Jason told me I'm not allowed to say drink wine in the recipe, so I just have to tell you out loud. All right. So forgive me if I forget. All right. I was recently in a cooking competition, and I can just say that I made something very similar to this on the competition, all right? And it went over pretty well, so just gonna leave that there. So feeling your saute pan, make sure it's hot, right? Kind of hover your hand over it. You're gonna feel that residual heat over here. Oh, yeah, so, yeah, Chef Tyra, if you're not gonna eat them right now, yeah, go ahead and save them, and then you can kind of cook them off a little bit later when you're gonna eat them closer to that time. Yeah, no problem, no problem. And so for cooking our steak, we're gonna want another 1 to 2 ounces of that neutral oil. So you got a little more canola oil back there. You wanna add another couple of tablespoons. Again, just a thin layer in the bottom of your pan once you see it starting to get kind of hot. Right, just that little layer in the bottom of your saute pan. And we're gonna wanna wait until we see like the oil smoking. And because we're using that neutral oil, that smoking doesn't mean burned, right? Canola oil is a good frying oil. You can crank that all the way up to high heat. Coconut oil, sesame oil, avocado oil, those are other neutral oils that you can just crank the heat on. Grapeseed oil is a great one. We're just gonna use canola oil here because it's very easily accessible. So you're going to want to wait until you see it smoking, right? We do want to see that smoke point on this oil. That means our pan is super, super hot. And that's how you preserve that pinkness on the inside. And that's how you don't get it overcooked on the outside. If it's super ripping hot, you're going to build that crust and get that nice pink in the middle. All right, we can do all the things. So this is one of the most important moments in class. We call it activating our tongs. So give them at least 3 clicks over here. You thought I forgot, huh? I didn't forget. All right, click those tongs, otherwise they don't work. That's like a very professional, important chef technique. All right, so you're gonna see over here that your oil eventually is kind of smoking. Give me a thumbs up if your oil's like super hot and you're ready to cook some steak. Anybody side thumbing? No, okay, excellent. So we're all gonna start this together. Chef Jerbear, can we get a 30-second timer on this bad boy?
Absolutely.
Awesome, all right, so land your steaks on that pan, chefs, ready to go. I like to give mine a little press to make sure that they hit that pan, right? Make sure all that surface area is actually touching the pan so there's not gonna be any blonde spots. And off we go. If you shake your saute pan, the steaks are gonna move because they're not stuck. That's awesome, right? That is awesome. All right, flip those babies over. That is our first flip. All right. Chef Karen, those are looking awesome. Nicely done. Margaret and Craig, those are beautiful. All right. Off we go, chefs. Off we go. All right. That is another timer flip on the filet. So you see that first time around on that first flip, we didn't get a perfect crust all the way across the top, right? There's some blonde spots, maybe it's not brown or crusty at all. But remember, we're preserving the integrity of the inside. The crust will build as you continue to flip, all right? So if they're looking a little blonde, don't panic just yet, right? Not yet. All right, it is officially time for more flipping. Ooh. All right, now I'm getting a little good crust going. It will build and build and build. All right, so we're doing really great over here. Another flip of the steak. And so when you're whenever you're cooking protein, we're flipping it a lot, right? And so whenever you flip your steak back and forth, try to land it in a new spot in your saute pan, because those are the hot spots, right? Wherever your steak was living is now no longer the hottest part of your pan. So when you flip it over, put it to the other side. That way, that part is going to be extra super hot, and you're going to build that crust a little bit faster. So I'm going to flip it like over here, there we go. So Chef Carolyn and Elizabeth, if yours are like kind of odd shaped, if yours aren't like perfectly circular, one of the things you can do is like truss your meat. So if you had some like butcher's twine or something, if you just tie a little piece of butcher's twine around your filet, you can get it more in a perfect circle. Today we're not super worried about that. You know, if we're at Acarello or a Michelin restaurant, then yeah, you're gonna tie it off. You're gonna make it perfectly round. It has to be perfect, right? Because it's elite. Today we're not looking for elite, but we are looking for super delicious. All right, so we're flipping it over again over here. All right, so it's not really about how many flips, it's about the feel. All right, so Brendan Andrew asking some great questions. How many flips? I'm not super sure, chef. All right, until medium rare, it's gonna be your ring and pinky finger. It's gonna feel something like this. All right, so I'm coming down, I'm pushing on my steak. It's feeling really squishy. If your meat is very squishy, squishy means very rare. All right, mine is exactly raw on the inside. All right, exactly raw. All right, we're doing another flip on these bad boys over here. Woo. Kind of looks like a Snoop Dogg concert in my studio right now, but I promise it is the steak. All right, we're doing another flip over here on these bad boys. All right. All right, I'm thinking, all right, Brandon, Andrew, I'm coming back to that question, how many flips for medium rare? You're probably gonna cook it for a total of like 5 minutes. So five times two flips per minute would be 10. Thank you, Bear Bear. Math is hard. So about 10 flips. All right, we're building some serious crust over here. It's looking great. We got that nice crust on the outside. All right, Margaret and Craig, those are looking fantastic. Chef Lucky has towel over the shoulder. That means business towel. That means I am not here to play. Yes, Chef. Chef Tom, hydrating, excellent. Yeah, if you want to sip and flip on these steaks, right? The old sip and flip maneuver, now is the time. I still got some serious squish in the middle of my fillets over here, so mine are pretty rare over here. Yeah, so Margaret and Craig, we're going to do the edges. Yeah, for sure. Team Lucky, that's looking great. Karen, those are looking awesome. Oh, Ed and Andrea, those are beautiful. All right. Yeah, we are crushing this, guys. All right, so just doing a little check out here. Who is looking to cook their steak rare? Give me a thumbs up for rare. Rare? All right, cool. How about medium rare? Give me a thumbs up, medium rare. All right, medium? Who's medium? Couple mediums. Anybody medium well? Anybody well done? That makes me so happy. All right. I wasn't going to like, wasn't going to judge you, but that does make me happy. All right. So for my folks who are looking for rare, for anybody who wants to do rare, go ahead and start doing your edges. All right, so when you get your edges, you can get those a little bit seared off as well. And just kind of roll them in that fat, right? You've got all that canola oil at the bottom of your pan over here. Hold the pan up and you can kind of flip them around, get all those edges nice and seared. All right, medium rare people, start doing your edges now. People who want rare, go ahead and start basting. When you baste, turn your heat to low. Anybody who's basting, heat on low, and go ahead and baste. Medium rare friends, start cooking your edges. And when you baste something, you're essentially just giving it a little butter bath, right? All the alliums and the herbs right here are infusing in our butter and our canola oil. And then you're just bathing those steaks, which also helps the cooking process, right? This is kind of like that last little intense bit of cookery before we get them out of the pan. All right. How are my medium rare friends doing on those edges? Oh, Chef Karen, that looks gorgeous over there. Nicely done. Yeah, Chef Karen is actively basting as we speak over here. Excellent. All right, so I'm pushing on my steaks. Feels a lot like my finger nugget. All right, if your steak feels like the correct finger nugget that you wanted, that's great. Margaret and Craig getting those edges going, basting. Excellent. All right, so my people who want a medium steak, you probably want to start doing your edges right about now. All right, medium. Start doing your edges. Once you get that golden brown on the edges, go ahead and turn your heat low and you start basting as well. All right. I know it's a little confusing when we all want different temperatures, but I trust that you know what you want and that you can make that happen. All right. I believe in you. I really do. Because if I can do it, you can do it. I promise. All right. So once you have basted your steak, right, you cooked it to the internal temperature you wanted, you hit the edges and got them a little golden brown as well. You've basted your steak to perfection. Now is the time, right, that you want to find that cooling rack. And let these babies take a rest, right? They have had quite the day, and they need a minute. I like to put all my alliums on top of my filet when I rest them. All right, so I know that was very smoky and fast and warm, all right, but I definitely want to know how those steaks are looking. I know we're at various different points of cooking right now, right? I know that. Show off wherever you're at. I want to see how it's going. Show off those Rolls Royce of proteins, guys. Like, it doesn't get better than a filet mignon. Chef Carol, that is gorgeous. Nicely done. Karen, nice. That's beautiful. Team Lucky act. Oh, look at that basting action, Chef. Yes. Oh, Kathy, that's perfect. All right. Beautiful. Margaret and Craig killing it over there. Excellent. Chef Michael, this looks beautiful. Nice and done. Chef Carolyn and Elizabeth, look at you go. Those are beautiful, Chef. All right. Tom, those are excellent looking over there. Nicely done. Brent and Andrew, there you go, Chef. Those are perfect. Oh, Team Skateri crushing it over here on the steak game. Nicely done. All right, Team Launch, excellent. Oh, those looking perfect. Resting it up, Janet. Nicely done over there. Alan Kelly, those are awesome looking guys. Nice, nice char on it. Team Lizzie, those are beautiful. Peeking out from behind the steak over there. I see you, Chef. Nice. Chef Anna, those are beautiful. All right. Chef Jeffrey, crushing it over here. All right, and Andrew doing the final baste over there. Excellent. So, I know you've all cooked steak at home before. Maybe it might not have been a filet, maybe it was, all right? But, in any event, anytime you cook steak, all these little tips that I've given you throughout the day don't seem like they add up to very much, but they really do change the game if you do them all completely, right? The tempering, the drying, the seasoning, the basting, and now the resting. And especially the flipping. My goodness, how did I forget that? The flipping and now the resting, all right? And so anytime you cook protein, you want to rest it for at least as long as you cooked it for. I know sometimes I say half, but I've changed my mind. You want to rest it for like 5 minutes, all right? You want to make sure all that steak juice stays in your steak. If you tried to carve it right now, you would have steak juice everywhere except in your steak, and that's the only place that we want it, all right? So we're going to let it hang out over there. It's going to soak all those juices back up. Any of the juice that might have kind of collected at the bottom of your sheet pan from your resting rack, we can incorporate that fallen juice into our sauce a little bit later. So don't worry, we'll use that juice too. Steak juice. All right, I know that was really hot and fast and smoky, so give yourself a little wine break over here, right? The steak cooking portion of class always happens to be a little bit wild. We're all on different pages, right? But at the end, we come together, we have a little wine, and we work it out, right? All right, so we are pretty much ready to finish this red wine sauce, and that's the last component of this dish, right? So coming back to our red wine reduction, right? You reduce half a bottle of red wine. We added in about 1¾ cups of beef stock and reduce that again. And so mine's been off heat for a while now. All right, and so I'm gonna add a little bit more heat to this before I can emulsify the butter in. So if yours has been off heat for a minute and it's no longer nice and hot, turn it back on to like maybe medium heat is fine. And then we're just gonna kind of season this up and finish it with a little butter, all right? So I've got about 1/2 cup or so of liquid left between the reduction and the beef stock over here. Just gently heating it back up so that it comes up to temperature and I can actually emulsify in that butter. Exactly. And while it comes up to heat, sneak another mushroom bite. Yeah, you know, we call those chef snacks. All right. And you are allowed to chef snack away all day. All right. So back to that stick of butter. All right. We only have a little bit left, but we want to grab two more tablespoons for this sauce over here. All right, so my sauce is now back up to temperature. So using my whisk, I'm just gonna emulsify in this butter. And when you emulsify something, you're basically just setting it with butter. It's gonna get nice and delicious. Boost of flavor up in here, a little bit of fat into this situation. And anytime you're doing a reduction, you never really want to season it except at the end, which I know goes against any kind of seasoning principle that I've ever taught in a class, right? Which is to build flavor slowly over time. When you're doing a reduction, you actually want to do the exact opposite and only season it at the end, because if you reduce something that's salty, it's just going to concentrate the salt, all right? Then you're going to have a little salt bomb of sauce, and that's not what we want, right? We want this luxurious red wine sauce. So using a nice red wine, using high quality beef stock, mounting it with butter, seasoning it at the end, this is going to be beautiful. If you find yours is a little bit bitter, you can always add a little pinch of sugar. All right. If you find that maybe your wine was a little on the bitter side and it reduced down kind of funky, you can add a little pinch of sugar and that will fix it. All right. And so in case anyone tastes this and they're like, yikes, this needs something. What is it? It's a pinch of sugar. All right. So depending on the bottle of wine you got, that's all that it is, right? That's all that you'll need. So I'm gonna go in for my taste test over here before I add a little salt. It needs salt, all right? It needs salt, that's for sure, all right? I'm gonna add a pinch, right? Always add salt slowly. You can always add more salt, but it's really hard to take the salt out once you've already added it in there. All right, how's it tasting out there? All right, we got some thumbs up out here. Excellent, excellent. Chef Julian is giving me a thumbs up on our red wine sauce. Excellent, chef. I love it. All right. So, give it a little season, taste it again. Ooh, there we go. You can't hear me. Can we hear me? Okay. Is your volume down? Did you get muted somehow? Computers are not my strong suit, but I'm really good at making food. Alan Kelly, better now? No, not quite. All right, well, we're pretty much done, honestly. So you're good to go. You're not missing that much. Jeremy will type in the chat for you. All right, so our red wine sauce is delicious. Yeah, that's going to be our sauce for our filet over here. Boom. All right. Did anybody have to add sugar, or the wine was good enough? The sugars in the wine caramelized enough? Nice. All right. Awesome. Awesome. All right. So we're pretty much ready to go ahead and start putting this all together. So we confit some potatoes. We need to strain the potatoes out of the olive oil. You should save this olive oil. I just made you use an entire pint of olive oil. Please don't throw that away, right? You've now created garlic flavored rosemary thyme infused olive oil, right? So you can use this in salads, use it as your salad dressing oil component. You can use it to flavor anything, right? You now have a flavored olive oil. So just label it, throw it in your fridge, you're good to go. And so this is where your setup comes in from your strainer over here. All right, so strain the oil off your potatoes over here. And you can just pull your potatoes right out of here. So they've got that garlic allium flavor to it. We add some herbs in there. Again, this olive oil is now infused with herbs and garlic, and maybe shallot if you remember to put some in there. So make sure you save that, right? I suggest saving any kind of infused olive oil in your fridge. It will congeal, but it always melts down really nice. For anybody looking to get wild, I see some of you staring at me. All right, if you want to get wild, what you can do is if you cut your fingerling or potato in half, you can then sear the cut side in your steak pan using all the steak juice. Does anybody want to off-road and try that? So many people flagging me down. Excellent. Okay. If you don't want to do that, then you're ready to just plate it up and have a good time, right? You're done. You're done. But for my off-roading friends, find your saute pan, put that back on the stove. And we probably want about high heat again, right? Medium high to high. Because these are already cooked, now we're just going to get them nice and crispy. Right? Who doesn't like a crispy potato? So just lengthwise down your potato. If you kind of seesaw your knife, you won't tear the skin quite as much, and you'll get that really nice cut without the skin looking all crazy. Team Launch, I love you back.
Hey, Chef Chuck, how thick are we supposed to be doing the potatoes? Slicing? Like a quarter of an inch or more?
Only if you want to get wild, all right? If you're trying to get wild with me today, which I highly endorse all the time, you just want to cut them in half, lengthwise.
Oh, in half. Okay, yeah. Got it. Thanks.
Yeah. No problem. This is a totally optional step, right? We are totally off-roading right now. It works, right? Please believe me, I've done this before, all right? So we're not off-roading completely, right? There is like a kind of a map, right? But that steak pan is now full of buttery, alumy goodness and steak juice. So just throw the cut side down. My butter is now sizzling, golden brown deliciousness. As you're throwing your potatoes in, make sure you throw them carefully so you don't splash very hot oil all over yourself. Throwing might not have been the right verb. Place them gently in your pan. And since we didn't season the potatoes, right? We did not season our confit potatoes because when you season oil, it denatures the oil. All right, so you season things that are confit after they come out of that oil. And so you can totally season these up right now with a little Bolognese truffle love. Boom. Crispy.
And do we need to get the oil back up to smoking before we put them in?
It doesn't need to be smoking, no. But you do want it to be like medium-high heat or to high. Medium-high to high heat is going to be great. Somewhere in that range. All right. So it's cast iron. It holds the heat really well. Your oil wasn't that hot or that cold when we put them back in here. And so mine are already getting that beautiful golden brown crispy bottom. The extra step is giving you life over here. Chefs, anytime you wanna off-road or get a little wild, you just let me know. There's always a way, right? If there's a will, there's a way. And believe me, there's some will over here to get wild. So anytime you wanna get wild, we can do it. We can. But one thing, just make sure you're hydrating, right? We've done a lot of things today. Just make sure you're still staying hydrated. It is a very essential part of any Truffle Shuffle recipe. You don't have to hydrate with anything alcoholic, but you should hydrate. Team Lucky, those potatoes look super fire over there. Yes, yeah, super, super fire. All right, so mine are nice and brown and crispy over here. So I'm going to call it a day and start removing them from my pan. Ooh. Ooh, that's a nice potato. All right.
Oh, yeah.
I used to be on a culinary team that catered weddings. I know, you didn't think I would have done something like that. Wild. I did. And we used to do these a lot, and this took a lot of work to make this amount of potato in this way for that many people at a wedding. Can you imagine? It took forever. It took absolutely forever. We had one kid on the team that was our designated mashed potato guy, and anytime a wedding had mashed potatoes, he would make like a giant pot of mashed potatoes, like one that I would sit in and you wouldn't even see the top of my floofy hair over here. Like, I would just be gone. You wouldn't see Tuck anymore. Poor kid would make mashed potatoes for like 8-hour shift. Poor kid, like, was just in the potatoes. Potato juice is what he called it. All right, so potatoes, you might want to check one, eat one, make sure it's seasoned and delicious. All right, and then we're pretty much ready to carve our steak. Now, it's a very controversial thing that I'm going to tell you right now. Sometimes I don't slice the filet. Sometimes I just place it whole because it's kind of a presentation piece, right? This is the Rolls Royce of protein. So it depends on how you want to serve it. If you're going to eat it right now and just dig in there, maybe you want to slice it ahead of the time on your cutting board and not get real wild on the plate. I'm going to plate one slice and one not sliced. All right. When you slice protein, you want to find the sharpest knife you own. Tuck your fingers behind your knuckles, right? No finger juice on the meat. And seesaw your knife back and forth. And if you seesaw your knife back and forth, that's how you get those clean edges. Boom. Yum. All right, that is what we call yum. All right, so slice up those fillets if you like. You can also do a whole presentation piece, super soigné that way. Soigné in French means fancy, all right? So we've got a couple methods of plating options over here. DJ Jerbear is gonna hook us up with, I'm sure you figured, some inspirational French plating music, all right? And I'm gonna give you 2 minutes to plate. On the cooking competition I was in, we got 90 seconds. I'm gonna let you have 2 minutes. All right, so in 2 minutes, we're gonna have a little show and tell.
Qui dit études dit travail, qui dit taf te dit les thunes, qui dit argent dit dépense, qui dit crédit dit créance, qui dit dette te dit huissier, lui dit assis dans la merde, qui dit amour dit les gosses, dit toujours et dit divorce, qui dit proche te dit deuil, car les problèmes ne viennent pas seuls. Sourd de la veille, alors on sort pour oublier tous les problèmes. Alors on danse. 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 Que ça, ce serait la mort. Quand tu crois enfin que tu t'en sors, quand y en a plus, et ben y en a encore. Et ça, c'est tous les problèmes, les problèmes ou bien la musique. Ça te prend les tripes, ça te prend la tête, et puis tu pries pour que ça s'arrête. Mais c'est ton corps, c'est pas le ciel. Alors tu bouges plus les oreilles, et là tu cries encore plus fort. Mais ça persiste, alors on chante. Alors on chante. Alors on chante.
No, Jackson Pollock over here.
Alors on chante.
Alright.
Et puis seulement quand c'est fini, alors on danse.
Hit your stick. eggs with a little Balinese truffle salt to finish. That's always a nice touch, a little crispy, crunchy of that beautiful sea salt. All right, but that's enough about my plating. I have to look at that all week long. I want to see what you made here today. That's what makes me happy. Oh my goodness, Chef Lucky, that is absolutely phenomenal over there, guys. Nice. Oh, Carolyn Elizabeth, that is a perfectly cooked filet over there, guys. Nicely done. Tom, beautiful job over there, Chef. Team Launch crushing it today. Excellent. Oh, Chef Anna, that is beautiful. Michael, nicely done. Brenda and Andrew, beautiful plate up over there, guys. Team Lizzie, executing a beautiful dish. Ann and Andrea, crushed it over there, Chef. That is gorgeous. Kathy, woo, look at that plate, Chef. Nicely done. Carrie Townsend, that is beautiful over there. Oh my goodness. Woo. Wow, Rolls Royce, we pulled it out. Oh my goodness, keep going, don't stop now. Pam and Pat, that is beautiful. Carol D over here, crushed it. Nicely done. Wow, guys, these are beautiful plates. If there was any time to remember to take a photo and tag me on Instagram, today is really the day, I'm telling you, right? Try to take 1 minute before you dig in. And you can tag Truffle_SF and, oh, Ebony Miller over there, beautiful. And definitely tag Little Chef Tucker on Instagram, because I am little and I am Chef Tucker, all right? Both of these things are true. And if you are a VIP member, you can also post your photos in our VIP lounge, and I will go ahead and check it out, all right? If you aren't a member yet, what is you doing? Be a member. It's kind of a cool exclusive club. We're really awesome. We hang out and eat food and drink wine, like, a lot. It's like this thing. All right, so these have been absolutely gorgeous plates today, guys. You have made me so proud. You really knocked it out of the park today. They look amazing. Next week, we're headed to Morocco. All right, we're going to continue to eat our way around the world. Next weekend is Morocco, and I would love to see you there. Being a member is the best. Do it. All right, you heard it here first from Chef Tom. Being a member is the best. Team Launch added a lobster tail up in here. Wow, we're going full surf and turf mode, Chef. Yes, classic. Awesome. Well, guys, I hope you enjoyed this dish. Dig in. Definitely tag those photos. There is a very important question in the chat. Can I tell you more about the cooking competition? I will next week. When we go to Morocco, I will be able to tell you more. I have signed an NDA. I can't actually tell you anything just yet. But next week, I will spill all the secrets. But just a little hint. Have you seen any cool commercials lately? So, I can't tell you anything, but if you happen to see a commercial, that's not my fault.
Can you link to the commercial?
I like you, Karen. I like you. So, you guys, dig in and enjoy this beautiful meal. Eat it while it's hot. Enjoy your friends and family. Finish up some delicious wine out here. You have all become some solid, solid gastronomy gangsters. This was not an easy class. None of my classes are ever going to be easy. You know that they're going to be medium or hard. We now have them labeled just in case. But you guys are crushing it. Keep honing those chef skills. Enjoy. All right. Enjoy, guys. Take care. Have a good night. Thank you.
Thank you. This was awesome.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
كلمة واحدة أبرك من كلام كتير ما بعرفش أكون رومانسي لكن عليكي بغير مش بثبت لك إني جامد ولا عايز أبان تقيل أنا 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 بناديكي
يا حبيبي
بناديكي
تعالي لي
بناديكي
أنا هنا
بناديكي
تعالي لي
بناديكي
يا حبيبي
بناديكي
أنا هنا
بناديكي
يا حبيبي
بناديكي
يا حبيبي
يا حبيبي يا حبيبي tu es tombé comme la pluie t'as dévoué dans ma petite vie dans ma vie comme un ovni
حبيبي يا حبيبي يا حبيبي يا حبيبي حبيبي يا حبيبي يا حبيبي يا حبيبي
يا حبيبي يا حبيبي
يا حبيبي يا حبيبي
يا حبيبي يا حبيبي
يا حبيبي يا حبيبي
triste soir, comme il y en a par milliers, quand cet homme est venu me voir pour parler. Et même s'il était tard, qu'on m'attendait pour dîner, je savais que c'était lui que j'attendais.
How's it tasting out there?
It's delicious.
Fantastic. Nice.
But you're not going to be telling them about it next week.
I hear that the beginning of this week that they're going to make the announcement officially. So,
no, I'm just saying you're not going to be there next week. You kept saying you were going to be there next week.
You're going to be with us.
I know exactly when I have class.
Awesome.